Last week we talked about Jehoshaphat, and Jehoshaphat has something else to say. So we're going to talk about him again today. Amen? Amen. So let's go to 2 Chronicles, chapter 20 of 2 Chronicles. Last week we talked about it's time to take your position. And we took our position. And if you were not here and did not hear that message, you're doing yourself a disservice. You need to hear each message builds on the other as God brings us to a climax of the return of the Lord. I believe that with all of my heart. I can't help it. Nobody else is teaching it anywhere around very much. But listen, there's always that Issachar group. Oh, now if you don't know what that means, you need to look it up. Glory, it's in your Bible. Hallelujah. The ones that could understand the signs and the end of the times. It's what the Bible called that group. And so, you know, there's always been a group ahead of a group. Always been a remnant inside the remnant. Always, always. Hadn't been very big, but they were dynamic in what they brought to pass. And I'm believing, God, we are a part of that part, that God is allowing us to be a part of what he is doing. So today, I want to talk to you about five tremendous lessons from Jehoshaphat. I mean, amazing lessons that I think once you hear it, I think they could put some things in perspective. I think you're going to see some things you haven't seen before. It's just going to be amazing about how you walk in the abundant life and how you can move and see things of eternal value reign supreme in your life, and you can see yourself be victorious in any and every situation. Not half of them, all of them. Look at your neighbor and say, all of them. Wow, there's some truths in this message. It is amazing to me. So I want today to talk about, again, the man himself and what every disciple should learn from his lives. So let's go to 2 Chronicles and put the story together. Beginning in 2 Chronicles in verse 1, you remember we read down through verse 24 last week. And it talked about that there were three armies that out of the blue came against Jehoshaphat, caught him totally and completely off guard. He was not expecting it to happen at all. They came up and just surprised him immediately. And we talked about, have we not ever been surprised? Have we not ever been caught off guard? Have we not ever found ourselves in a position that, my goodness, I wasn't expecting this. I didn't know what was going on. And the key is what you did or what was happening to you. And Jehoshaphat sets the perfect example. He tells us how to win when everything is coming against us and it appears there's absolutely no way for you to win. So we have three nations coming against Israel at this time. He's terrified. The Bible says that Jehoshaphat was terrified. He's terrified of what's going on. And then he does, though, he immediately, not secondary, immediately ran to the Lord for help. And so we find out in verse 5, Jehoshaphat stood before the community of Judah and Jerusalem in front of of Judah and Jerusalem. And in the front of the new courtyard at the temple of the Lord, he prayed. Jehoshaphat himself prayed. O Lord God of our ancestors, you alone are the God who is in heaven. You are ruler of all the kingdoms of the earth. You are powerful and mighty. No one can stand against you. Man, what a prayer. O our God, did you not drive out those who lived in this land when your people Israel arrived? And did you not give this land forever to the descendants of your friend Abraham? Your people settled there, built their temple to honor your name, built this temple to honor your name. And then they said, whenever we are faced with any calamity, such as war, plague, or famine, we can come to stand in your presence before this temple where your name is honored. We can cry out to you to save us, and you will hear us, and you will rescue us. Glory to God. That's a knowing, isn't it? That's a trusting in God. And then he reminds them about all the armies that are coming. And then he says in verse 30, he comes around and he says, verse 12, O our God, won't you stop them? We are powerless against this mighty army that is about to attack us. We do not know what to do, but we're looking to you for help. Then he goes in and he goes down and he talks about the Spirit of the Lord came on one of the men and that he began to prophesy. And then he began to name, which I think is absolutely precious. He goes back and names five generations. And he talks about that God had been faithful to the five generations regarding Jehoshaphat. He goes back and talks about that. And he talks about that God, and proving the point that God takes care of his friends and his friends' friends and the descendants of his friends. So you want to be a friend of the Lord. Hallelujah. I don't know how many of you checked back to see what kind of heritage you had back in there. But, you know, again, instantly I began to try to find out where I could get some more friendship going. Hallelujah. With the Lord God Almighty. Then he says in verse 15, listen, all you people of Judah and Jerusalem. Listen, King Jehoshaphat. This is what the Lord says. Do not be afraid. Don't be discouraged by this great army. For the battle is not yours. The battle is God's. The battle belongs to the Lord. Don't you even try it. He's got it, is what he's saying. He says, he's got it. And then he tells them what to do and how the enemy's going to be coming up. And then verse 17, but you will not even need to fight. Take your positions, then stand still and watch the Lord's victory. He is with you. Man, don't you want to hear that? God is with you. Oh, people of Judah and Jerusalem, do not be afraid or discouraged. Go out against them tomorrow, for the Lord is with you. Man, that's all I need to hear. I don't know about you, but I love that whispering of the Holy Spirit. Hey, I've got this one. Glory to God. The Lord is on our side. Church, you should be shouting. And I shouldn't be having to tell you to. I'm telling you, God is on your side. He's working behind the scenes. He's doing things that you can't even see. God is always working on your behalf. He's always on your side. He's always saying, hey, chill out. I got this. He's always saying, matter of fact, we'll do better if you keep your nose out of it. He's always trying to tell us, just let me handle this. And what does he want us to do? Praise and worship. Praise and worship. Just trust him and worship. Worship him, worship him, worship him. You say, I'm so nervous I can't worship. Well, get over it and begin to say, oh, praise you, Jesus. Whatever you have to do, just say, oh, Lord, I'm scared, but praise you anyhow. Hallelujah. I'm going to bless the Lord at all times. I will forever praise his name. And through trembling lips, you give praises to the Lord God Almighty. I will never leave you nor forsake you. If I said it, will I not do it? I'm just quoting scripture. That's all I'm doing. When you quote scripture, you're just quoting what your God said. I'm just, if scripture's not over here, God's over here. No, the scripture is God talking to you. Glory to God. And then it says, the king, 18, the king Jehoshaphat bowed low with his face to the ground, and all the people of Judah and Jerusalem did the same, worshiping the Lord. And then on verse 20, early the next morning, the army of Judah went out into the wilderness of Tekoa. On the way, Jehoshaphat stopped and said, listen to me, all you people of Judah and Jerusalem. Believe in the Lord your God, and you will be able to stand firm. Believe in his prophets, and you're going to succeed. Believe the word that you heard from the Lord. In other words, put your trust right there and chill out. Because you can't really praise until you can chill out. You can't praise until you know. You can't praise until you trust. You can't praise until you believe. You can't praise until you know God's got it. But once it sinks in, God's got this. And once that sinks into you, and you think about it until you think, well, you know, he's not a man that he should lie. He said this. This is what he said he would do. He said this isn't my battle. He said not to get all worked up. He said not to have a nervous breakdown. He said, cast your care upon me because I care for you. He said he'd be there in every situation and circumstance. He said he's bigger than anything and everything. That's what he said. Hallelujah. And he's not a man that he should lie. So what is my problem? My problem is I'm not believing him. Well, that went over really well. Hallelujah. And then he said, after consulting the people, 21, the king appointed singers to walk ahead of the army, singing to the Lord and praising him for his holy splendor. And this is what they sang. Give thanks to the Lord. His faithful love endures forever. Praise the Lord for his mercy endures forever. At the very moment, woohoo, they began to sing. I mean, they didn't have to sing the whole thing. I mean, they didn't even go through one verse. I mean, they just had to open their mouth. The same identical thing that the priest has to do at the Jordan River. They didn't have to walk. They had to touch the water. Why don't we go wake up? But it takes rush for that first step. Takes trust for that first step. Takes trust for that first step. Priest, you go ahead of them and you carry and you step into the flood of the Jordan River. But when you read it, all they did was put their toe in. And then, shoo, glory to God. And all they did here, you know, all they did, said, that's as far as they got. What were they singing? Praise the Lord. Praise. And then, whoa, that's not exactly how they did all the enemies, but you get the point. You get the point? The very minute they let something out, the very minute a praise came out, the very minute their trumpet blew, the very minute their mouth, their trumpet, the very minute it began to praise, the very minute, whoa! That's what the Bible says. At the very moment, not even minute, at the very moment they begin to sing and give praise, the Lord caused the armies of Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir to start fighting among themselves. The moment. Glory to God. Come on, church. If God did that in the Old Testament, what in the world do you think he'll do to the church? What do you think he will do to the redeemed of the Lord? What do you think he would do? He now lives inside of you. Glory to God. You better let out something. You better let your mouth be a trumpet of sound for the Lord God Almighty. God inhabits the praises of his people.
Do you live your life operating in hope, or do you walk in faith? Sandra's book, Preparations for a Move of God in Your Life, will help you move out of hope and walk in faith, because you can die in hope. In today's offer, Words of Life for Healing, 58 minutes of healing scripture ministered by Sandra, and as a point to release your faith, we'll include a prayer bandana that's been anointed with oil from Israel. To place your order, call or visit our website and request offer 137.
So when the army of Judah, verse 24, so when the army of Judah arrived at the lookout point in the wilderness, all they saw were dead bodies lying on the ground as far as they could see. Pay attention to the last verse. Not a single one of the enemy had escaped. Every single one. Now you understand that's three armies. That's three nations. We're not talking about 15 people. We're talking about multiple hundreds of thousands. Go back and read your Bible. We're not talking about maybe 2,000. We're talking about hundreds of thousands lay dead. No one escaped. And Judah did nothing. The nation of Judah, Jerusalem is part of Judah. Judah did nothing but say, praise the Lord. What they did was listen and obeyed. That's what they did. They listened and obeyed and got the results God said he would do. Verse 25, King Jehoshaphat and his men went out to gather the plunder or the spoil. That's where we pick up. They found vast amounts of equipment, clothing, and other valuables, more than they could carry. Wow. There was so much plunder or spoils that it took them 3 days just to collect it all. Now, we're talking about hundreds of thousands of an army going in. We're not talking about they didn't send 10 people out there. You got to get the picture. Sometimes we just don't see it the way it's written. On the fourth day, they gathered in the valley of blessing, which got its name that day because the people praised and thanked. Notice, the people praised and thanked the Lord there. And so it still is called this day the Valley of Blessing. Then all the men returned to Jerusalem with Jehoshaphat, leading them overjoyed that the Lord had given them victory over their enemies. They marched into Jerusalem to the music of harps and lyres and trumpets, and they proceeded to the temple of the Lord. When all the surrounding kingdoms heard that the Lord himself had fought against the enemies of Israel, the fear of God came over them. So Jehoshaphat's kingdom was at peace, for his God had given him rest on every side. Wow, what a God we serve! Whoa! All right, let's look at these lessons. Number one, tremendous lessons from Jehoshaphat. Number one, the spoils are the fruit of the strategy. In other words, the spoils are the plunder. Spoils are the plunder, are the results of your plan of action. Does that help us? Of your game plan. Your game plan will determine your spoils. And will determine the results of your strategy. However you strategize will determine what kind of results you get out of the battle. Are you following me? Not what God strategizes, what you do. However you strategize, when the enemy comes and catches you off guard and comes and hits you and you weren't expecting it from any angle, anywhere, what you strategize, how you respond to that situation determines the results of what will come of your spoils. Our priorities, you write this on the tablet of your heart, our priorities are important to God. Your priority, what you choose, what you put first, what is most important to you, what you do immediately, is very important to the Lord. Amen. He did what had become a part, listen to me, he did something that had become a part of his character. Amen. Look at your neighbor and say character. Amen. Oh, Lord, let us hear this. Yes. He did what had become a part of his character. He turned to God first about everything. What a character trait. Number two, your response to what comes your way has a direct influence on the spoils you will gather at the end of the battle. Please write this on the tablet of your heart. Self-reliance minimizes the spoils. Self-reliance, thinking you can handle it, will minimize what the plunder or the spoils or the goods will be. In other words, there could be tons and tons of spoils, but if you're going in as a self-sufficient person, they will not be there for you. The spoils are released when God wins the battle. God controls the spoils. Are you listening? Number three, your character determines your conviction or your beliefs or your opinions or your stance. Your character, who you are, determines your belief system. Who you are determines where you will stand, determines your priorities. Because of his relationship with God, Jehoshaphat, over time he learned to trust the Lord, even and especially when a crisis manifested. Mark this down, because some of you need to really hear this. It has to do with sickness. It has to do with anything and everything. Listen to me. Trust takes faith to a higher level. We've always put them on this equal standing. That's not necessarily so. Wow. Trusting will lead to obeying. Amen. You can forever tell yourself you don't have enough faith. Trust will build faith. But if you will just trust and forget about trying to build your faith, but trust God, faith will come. Hear me. So the main thing you need to decide, whatever's happening, I trust God in this. I'm not going to try to fix it myself. I trust God. And that God, and that will bring forth such faith, it will be amazing. Do you understand what I'm saying? You know, for some of us, it's easier to say, I trust God, than to say, I have enough faith. And yet, they do fall in the same ballpark. But people beat themselves up by saying they don't have enough faith. That's a cop-out for us. But trust is something you decide on your own. I trust them. I don't care whether you do or not. I trust them. I mean, there are people, how many people here, I've said over and over again, I know you don't trust them. I trust them. And trust has a way of bringing the best out of people. Amen. Trust has a way of bringing that best out of them. Yes. When you trust them. You can say, well, I have faith they'll come around. No, there's a difference in saying, I trust them. I believe in them. I trust them. I trust God to get me through this. Everybody listening? Trust declares with conviction, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise will continually be in my mouth. Amen. Trust guards the heart when emotion would run wild. And in these days, it is critically important that the Lord's disciple understand, trust the Lord. Amen. Number four, waiting on God is humbling. Kings, presidents, and prime ministers are a proud bunch. They have to maintain an image. Leaders have to be inspired by the people who are in charge. Leaders have to make tough decisions. Yet, what kind of a leader admits in front of his people, we don't know what to do, we are helpless before our enemy? That's the thing that Jehoshaphat taught us. He wasn't worried about his image. His concern was for his nation. He knew they were in deep trouble unless God helped them out. Humbling yourself before God goes against every single trend that's happening in the American church today. Nobody's talking about submitting. Nobody's talking about doing anything like that. Everybody's talking about, you know, do your thing. In this season, you cannot afford to be caught up building your own self-esteem. Be far more concerned and knowing what it is to have God's esteem. And how do you know what God's esteem is? The Bible tells you. Esteem. What's the word esteem mean? Respect, admiration, favor, honor. The word says, this is the one I esteem. He who is humble and contrite in spirit and who trembles at my word. Contrite, repentant, regretful, humble, meek, respectful, submissive. And God's kingdom, humility is the queen of all virtues. I'm coming to an end. Self-sufficiency robs God of his glory. Amen. And robs you of the spoils. Because your strategy in facing a battle determines the spoils you will reap at the end of it. How you set out, what your priority is, with how you decide to handle something will determine what you will reap. Number five, God's twofold design for the end of every battle has two things in mind. One, that you will see the victory belongs to the Lord. Amen. And that you will collect the spoils in abundance. Amen. That's one thing. It's what God wants you to do. He wants you to see that the victory, that he did it. And he wants you to get all the spoils. Number two, that your response to victory will be the same as your strategy for the battle, worship and praise. That's why we sang worship songs this morning. Praise songs. Jehoshaphat teaches you to trust the Lord, to run to the Lord, to humble yourself, to let the Lord be who He is, Redeemer, Savior, Deliverer, and Lord. Disciples, grab hold of this truth. The weapons of your warfare are not flesh and blood. Victory is assured. Hear me. Victory is absolutely assured when praise and worship are your weapons and obedience is your lifestyle.
Do you live your life operating in hope, or do you walk in faith? Sandra's book, Preparations for a Move of God in Your Life, will help you move out of hope and walk in faith, because you can die in hope. In today's offer, Words of Life for Healing, 58 minutes of healing scripture ministered by Sandra, and as a point to release your faith, we'll include a prayer bandana that's been anointed with oil from Israel. To place your order, call or visit our website and request offer 137.
Out of the five lessons to learn from Jehoshaphat, the most important one is lesson one. He ran to God before anything else. He ran to God. He didn't know what to do. He knew that the problem was bigger than him. So what do? You go to the person that's bigger than you, and that is God Almighty. I know our lives are being changed by these messages, and we trust that your life is being changed as well. Go to sandrakennedy.org, go to our media tab, and you can watch the archived messages in full of all of this year and just take in what God is saying to us. Our prayer warriors are there. Call our prayer line. They'll stand with you. Our healing center streams Monday, Wednesday, and Fridays at 11 a.m. Eastern Time. You tune in to that classroom and take the Word of God in of what it has to say about your healing, and watch God be God in your life.
Do you live your life operating in hope, or do you walk in faith? Sandra's book, Preparations for a Move of God in Your Life, will help you move out of hope and walk in faith, because you can die in hope. In today's offer, Words of Life for Healing, 58 minutes of healing scripture ministered by Sandra. And as a point to release your faith, we'll include a prayer bandana that's been anointed with oil from Israel. To place your order, call or visit our website and request offer 137.